working at CERN for the last 4 years, and I've been in charge of like service manager for Linux. And there's a few other people from CERN today. So there's Jarek, my partner in crime in Linux, which is over there. Bring. And Jan, who is the cloud lead team leader, but not the cloud. So feel free to both of them as well later if you have questions. I will start with a short introduction to CERN. So our core business is basically accelerators. We are trying to smash protons and find cool physics. We have a lot of different accelerators. So basically, the biggest one and the one that we are running at full speed now is the LHC. It's a 27-kilometer ring that is spanned between France and Switzerland. And it generates a big amount of data. So this is where OpenStack will come handy, and we can scale quickly when we need more CPUs and memory. There's two big experiments, CMS and Atlas, that are working independently to validate results, basically. So the both experiments are working on detectors, but they are doing their own. So we can be sure that we have results that are coherent between both. Well, how something goes this day. I will present you now the cloud. So as Rich said, it's based on RDO. It's in service since July 2013. We did 4 rolling upgrades. So basically, wow. We moved from Grizzly to Havana, Havana Ice House, Ice House Kilo, and now we are in the process of Kilo to Liberty. A few specific things on our cloud. We are at the original hardware. We started the project a long time ago. We have different kind of hardware. The procurement at CERN is a bit different. We have to do some call for tenders, and every member can answer, and then the company that has the best and the best hardware in terms of price and the capacity win. So we don't have always the same processor type, so this is one of the challenges as well to deal with our cloud. We use KVM in Hyper-V. We still using both hypervisors. So of course, KVM is the big majority. I think we'll come back to numbers later, so I'll tell you how many we have. Ceph and NetApp, so we are mainly Ceph volumes. We have volumes and images on Ceph, and mainly images on NetApp. So we keep NetApp for the Hyper-V because there's no Ceph driver for Hyper-V yet. So this is why we keep NetApp at this time. Another challenge, we still have two different kinds of hypervisor OS. So we have Scientific Linux 6 and CentOS 7. So like 2 years ago, we announced that we won't be following Scientific Linux anymore, but we will move to CentOS. Our first hypervisor is still running 6, and we are in the process of migrating everything to CentOS, but it's still a challenge because we still have. I rebuilt the package for Juno for 6, then for Kilo, we did some tricks with virtual ARM in the home gateway to be able to run the compute nodes. So this is one of the big challenges as well. We are in transition from Kilo to Liberty. So I put in red heat and neutron because I heard yesterday that heat is already migrated to Liberty. And we have a cell with neutron as well, which is a big plus because we were still stuck with Nova Network at this time. So we are migrating from that. Then. The last thing I wanted to mention is we have pets and cattle, so we use OpenStack for service consolidation as well. So this is another challenge because you need to have different performance for different GMs. A few more words on the architecture. So we have two data centers. We call it Tier Zero. Basically, this is what we manage. So we have hypervisor. Split between these two data centers. So the second one is in Vigner, you can't see much in the map, Hungary. And we have 26 cells at this time and one region. The cells are mapped to different hardware, different location, different user, different experiments that allow us to deal with different use cases, basically. Just as I mentioned, we have many tiers around Europe that helping after tier zero that are sent to the grid. So if you want more details, I've got the URL here where you can see. This is not only Europe, there's the US as well, but I just put the bell grid from around here. Coming back to the architecture, so we have the top set controller. We have several physical nodes in high availability. We have RabbitMQ with MirrorQ, and IPA server VMs in the child cells. Child cell controller are all VMs, so as I said, and one controller per cell, basically. So this is a trade-off between complexity and failure impact. If we lose a child cell controller, we don't lose everything. So this is the design we chose. This is just a nice diagram of what I said. So as you see, we still have Nova Network mainly. We wrote the neutron plugin for our to adapt our network database, basically. So we have a test cell with neutron now, so it's moving on, and we hope to move fully to neutron soon. Few numbers. So at this time we have 4,600 hypervisor. It's close to 5,000. 1 year ago we were around 3,000, which is almost what we plan in terms of adding capacity. Majority is QMKVM. We have 150 Hyper-V, so it's just for specific use case as I mentioned before. And 2,000 of these hypervisor are far away, so. They are in Bigner with this 2 100 gig link. 145K core is what we have, so we more than doubled. Then the RAM, as you mentioned as well, doubled the RAM since a year. And we are around 15,000 VMs. And the plan for 2016 is to go higher and add the 65K core until spring, so basically we will get the hardware delivery soon and then the time to prepare and probably put that in production around end of the spring. We can't see much, but we are around 2 million, more than 2 million VM created over the time we have the cloud, and as I mentioned, around 15,000 VM. This graph after a few months ago, so maybe we are a bit higher this time.
We just hit 2.5 million.
Okay, so we hit 2.5 million. So basically, it go fast. There's a lot of experiment creating a lot of VM, destroying them. So the type of number of created VM is going fast. And 15,000 VM, it's stable at this time, right? We are around that more or less. In this line. So now I just wanted to mention that we got every 10 seconds of created identities at this time. So not bad. We have 2,000 images snapshot set from Glens. So this is what we have. And 1,500 volumes. So every cell can request volumes. We tripled that because it was really beginning a year ago, seen the part, so now we are at 1,500 volumes. And on top of that, we have the net app for the Hyper-V, but that will be around 100 volumes, I think. I don't have the exact number, but it should be fine. And RDO, so now I'm here to explain a bit what we use on RDO. So I wanted to put a big heart for PackStack because we love PackStack, so we'll explain you why. PackStack use Puppet first, so this is close to what we develop. We have a lot of students, like Cello, so people that are not staying forever at CERN, and this is really the first thing they do, PackStack mini-minis all in one, and they boot some OpenStack and they can develop on it, see how it works, basically without having production. So this is a really plus for us, and as well, it allows us to check the Puppet module to see how it goes. So we really love it. It's great. Test day, so please don't drop backstack.
Okay, I'll pass that on actually to the developers. I'm even taking
pictures.
That
was the message.
We take the picture too.
Yeah.
And of course, the test day, it was a test day yesterday, right?
Yep.
I couldn't make it to this one, but.
Yeah, yesterday and today, so it's.
Today as well, so yeah, if you have free time.
Not great timing, but.
So I'm trying at each test day, and a few people on the team are trying to build the pack stack and to see what is going on. So we try to be active. We're not. I am not as much as I would like, but. We try to onboard more team members. I mean, we have more people that are packaging now. We have more people that are working. So this is another big thing we like. And the community was really nice on the test day. You can really help. You can get help from anybody. And so we really enjoy this part as well. Now, this is just a summary of when we move to the our version of OpenStack. So basically in February 2014, after five months after Havana, we had Havana, so it goes like that. So this is another big thing we love, N-1, because it's great to have the last test RDO, but it's as well great to get the point release. We really like that with RDO, continuing to get point release in a timely manner, because there's a lot of bug fix, bug ported to point release, so this is something that we really depend on it. So as well, I mean, there's a lot of CI going on now, and Juno to Kilo was a bit slow on the minor release, because they were moving CI to new CentOS Cloud. It was a bit, so we really want to put emphasis that we need N-1, because the migration always takes time. So we really love to have Liberty on Liberty Day to have all the packages, but we need to keep in mind that we have a service in production, so to run, we depend very much on N-1. So as well, kudos to all people that are contributing to that, and we hope we can as well help a bit more.
Can you elaborate on the upgrade experience, since you're like using RPMs and the, so how was it?
In
as painful
of,
as you would expect, or?
No.
Jan will say a few words, maybe.
I can say a few words about that. In the beginning, it was extremely painful. There were no procedures, there were no tools, and also we made some deployment choices that made our life difficult. So what we now have is that for all the different components that Thomas listed there, you run them independently, most of them on virtual machines, otherwise on some physical hardware. That means that we can do the upgrade component by component. Mm-hmm. So the way we plan this is we first, when Kilo comes out, we do nothing at all. We wait for the first maintenance release of Kilo packages to come out, and that's when we start to get busy, because that's basically the easy bugs have been fixed.
Yeah.
Now the components themselves are largely independent. It doesn't really matter very much any longer in which order you do things, especially since we've separated stuff. Mm-hmm. So we start to do typically the smaller components. We've just done heat, but we would upgrade Keystone, Glance, work our way then towards Nova, which for us is, well, for everybody I suppose, is the big one. Because it's not just standalone components on virtual machines, it's also all the hypervisors. So by the time that that OpenStack upstream release Liberty, we get close to upgrading Nova to the previous N-1 mm-hmm. to Kilo. Once we've done that, we upgrade to Horizon, because we tailor that a little bit, and that basically is because it's so user visible, we basically then tell the users the upgrade is over. Right? This is basically when Liberty has come out, and then we start worrying about the next cycle. So we are now at the moment of actively doing nothing and waiting for Liberty itself, the first maintenance release of Liberty. I must say the upgrade experience works very well for us. Mm-hmm. We are able to test the stuff internally. We find very few problems with the RDO packages themselves.
Also,
we find them more with our integration, so we test that. And then the upgrades themselves go smoothly. Once we've done all that, we write a blog post and you can all read it.
Yeah, we have this, I put the URL at the end, so each upgrade experience was the summary of what we did. But honestly, RPM, YUM and RPM packaging, we never got a really big trouble. I mean, it was just a matter of getting on IRC and say, look, this version is not up to date. the transition between RDO repository and CloudSig repository was a bit painful, but it was during the time we were not starting the upgrade. So by the time Kilo 1 was ready, it was all okay. Mm-hmm. So we were not hit by it. So this is good. So I will continue.
Yeah, sorry.
No problem. It's fine. We have time anyway. So just for operation, I wanted to mention that we use Rundeck for daily operation automation. So that I have not been too much involved, but you can ask around for more detail if you want. Basically, it allows us to warn user. So when we have 100 hypervisors going down for a problem, and then it's sent to every VM owner that he will be fine or poorly, this kind of thing. Then another important thing for us, I didn't put a heart here, but we still have a EL6 to support forever, because the experiment, we had this big shutdown at CERN that lasts 2 years, until June this year, basically. And EL7 was not around here. So the experiment didn't migrate everything. So most of the client, most of the software are still running on EL6. So for us, in terms of cloud management, is not a big deal because we can migrate hypervisor, but on the client side, we'll still have to support. So this is something that was discussed at the Vancouver summit, that EL6 client could stay around. This is something that we are ready to work on, and we'll see how the community can help us in that. To show you a few numbers from, So basically we have around 8,000 EL6 still clients updating every day. So this is just to show you that it's a big chunk of our VMs. Okay. Contribution. So we did the OpenStack Juno for EL6. This was kind of the first thing we did with the RDO community. We come in and said, hey, we need EL6, so let's continue. So we tried. Thanks to Alan and Eke, I don't know if they are wrong. No. So it was very nice to have help from them. Seven package, we provide several package. Now we have another person in the team that is doing Murano in C2 API, so that can commit on Apple as well, so it's nice. It's going on, and we have another team member that joined the team that wasn't as well a contributor to Apple in the past, so we start to have a big team in terms of RPM management, which is quite nice, and we can work as if someone is more assigned to project, someone can take the maintenance of the package, so this is the goal we want to achieve long term. And we have few patches, as I mentioned, on Horizon, few patches on Nova Network. Everything can be found here if you want to have a look. So don't hesitate. Ask us questions. A quick summary now. So we kind of doubled the capacity since 2013, more than double actually. So this was a great choice for us in terms of scalability. And as I mentioned, we already plan to add more machine, and we have something that will be called the high luminosity. So basically, this is the next upgrade of the LHC, and that will come around 2025. And by then, they already know that we will need an immense CPU storage, epic storage. We have around 100 petabyte at this time of storage. They plan for the next run 3, to have 100 petabyte a year. So that would be another challenge in the storage world to maintain. And for the last run 5, it will be around 1 petabyte per experiment on the planning. So we will have a lot of challenges on the storage first, and then we'll need to manage all this data and to figure them. So yeah, that would be a big challenge, and it's not over. The cloud will be bigger, basically, it will still grow. And as I mentioned, the blog, so there's a lot of information on different topics. There's a few topics about tuning that are very interesting if you want to have a look by Arne. There's a lot of investigation. It looks like a blog post is short and it's easy, but it took like a few weeks to be able to get what was wrong. We got some CPU binding issue, we got a lot of issue, and I think If you are running OpenStack in production, it's quite nice to read at least the upgrade post. It will help you to understand what we did wrong, what we could do better. So just as a poll, who is running OpenStack in production here? Okay. Which version for the people that are running?
Depends.
Okay. And I think it's over. So if you want to shoot a few questions, ask us different things, I think we have more time.
Yeah, so I have one more about Neutron. What is the first, since you said you were migrating from Nova network to Neutron, so what are your first?
Maybe I will let Jan take this one because I'm not involved in this one.
Okay. So the CERN internal networking setup is rather convoluted and complicated and extremely stable, which is an asset, but it's also rather old fashioned. It dates to the 1990s. Okay. So CERN are not alone in that integrating OpenStack with its own existing network infrastructure has always been a pain. So we started before Neutron existed, we started before Quantum existed, so we found a way to tweak Nova network to integrate with our network infrastructure, and we have not been able to change that since. Now obviously Nova network is to be deprecated anytime soon, since a couple of years by now. So we've had three technical students, one after the other, looking at Neutron, and now we found one, well, not just technical students, but now we found a way to actually integrate Neutron instead of Nova Network. So the first thing that we're doing now these days is actually have a separate Nova cell where we use Neutron instead of Nova Network. Right? So we're just starting to test that now. It's important for us because Nova, because Neutron is also a prereq to get Magnum working properly. So the second step now will be to, we now want to make sure that everything works properly and performs properly, etc.
So you don't know yet.
Second step is need to find out how can we move 15,000 existing virtual machines from Nova Network. We'll let you know.
Okay.
My next question was the migration strategy. So
we have to define that exactly. If people have good ideas, please talk to me after.
So how do you manage your patches? If you have patches on Horizon, do you apply them after the package?
Basically we have a Koji inside CERN where we rebuild everything. So we have GitLab Koji and we have a workflow to rebuild pretty much everything. But everything is deployed as an RPM.
Okay, so you rebuild all the RDO packages?
Not all, just what we need.
Just what we need.
Yeah. So I thought I had a slide on that actually. Did I miss it? Oh, it disappeared. Okay, I was supposed to. Maybe I didn't. No. Okay, no. Sorry. So yeah, we have an internal way of building RPM since few years. We used it for the project, and so we can send Git URL to the building system. It builds everything, and then we have Puppet. We have two different environments. So we have a QA and a production environment. So basically. We have few hypervisor and cell controllers that are in QA, so we test on them first, we upgrade everything, and when we are happy with the result, we move the environment to production, and then package are upgraded on bigger cell and all the infrastructure. So we have a branch in Git per environment in Puppet. So this is how we deal. So we can basically test things quick. Mm-hmm. Is it okay?
Two questions actually. So are you using RDO for all of your computing at CERN now?
All of your computing?
All of your computing. Right. So the thing I'm wondering about mainly is the MTACs, because you're obviously one of the biggest HPC centers on the planet, and you talked about VMs, you didn't mention bare metal at all, so I'm wondering, are you running the largest HPC? Yeah.
So the batch workload basically, which is what import to the experiment, where the crunch jobs, it's all VM now.
Right.
We have a few projects on the side, HPC doing some, but it's really minimum number of machines, but most of the batch queue are on OpenStack now.
And the second question, you mentioned the tier one data centers around spread around the world, is that built on OpenStack or is that a completely different system?
It's their choice. We have this conference twice a year where we meet a few of the labs called HEPIX. So if you look for HEPIX, you will find the talks, basically. Yeah. And it starts to be the de facto standard of OpenStack, but there's some people on Nebula still, so there's... We don't control the tier. The tier just crunch more data, but we don't have control and we don't impose anything. We share our knowledge. Maybe you want to add something on that?
Yeah, there's definitely been a trend in the recent years to consolidate under OpenStack. So many of the labs, as Thomas said, independently investigated different cloud solutions 3, 4, 5 years ago, but it's consolidating on OpenStack now. CentOS is also a predominant operating in those environments. So what we are doing at CERN, we are not imposing our solution, but it's obvious that many of our partner labs are interested in what we're doing and are following.
And what would be like the second option after OpenStack?
No,
is there any real competition?
No,
okay.
I think there's not a second player that is at least in what I saw in the last meetings. I mean, it's maybe not reflect the complete truth because there's some people presenting, but we didn't see a major also cloud platform yet. Any other question? I think no.
Yeah, about sales. During your upgrade to Liberty, you will change sales V2, or you plan to change your sales design for the...
That's a very good question and a difficult one to answer. So one in our team is one of the few sales experts in OpenStack, Bill Miro. So we are contributing to sales V2, but I don't feel it's ready right now. So we're struggling with the original sales, and I'm not sure if we're going to go completely V2 or when we're going to go there.
Not for Liberty.
I doubt that.
Yes, I have one. Are you using Docker containers?
So, and hidden slide, we just say.
Ah!
So we start to look at
the magic.
But basically, we don't have anything on production yet, but we have a cell where we can create some Docker. So, as it was mentioned here, we looked at LXC as well, but in terms of maintenance, this is pretty much dead, so we decided, because the integration with OpenStack was a bit better before Liberty. I don't know the status in Liberty, I didn't look so much in the status of LXC, but okay. So we are doing some tests, and we have some specific things we need in containers for the experiments that may not speak very well to you, but this is what we are going to do right now. And we can do it through Kubernetes. We will see. So we can. I mean, it's just a test bed now. We have a Docker hub inside. I mean, Yarek set up the Docker hub inside CERN, so we can start to have user to see how it will evolve and what people want to deploy as container. But of course, in terms of overhead, it will be nice for the batch system. This is something where we can. Easily gain a bit of performances compared to VM. That will need to be proven, because I think the overhead on VM now are on 3%, just after Arne tweak with Kilo 1. So we'll have to see. There's no
3% over.
On the VM, on a full VM, on an hypervisor, basically.
That's pretty good, actually.
3 to 5, yeah, I think. Yeah. There's a post about that if you want to read as well. Okay.
Yeah, you spoke of Murano. So do you provide this service to your users, or it's only you said you contribute to this project? You have made the packages?
Exactly. For the moment, it's not in production, and we're looking at it.
No, we've got somebody who's interested to look at it, and then of course we found that there are no packages. So we found somebody else a packager to start packaging.
So no, you don't.
And then you found that Congress client needed to be packaged as well.
All the dependencies.
Mistral client. Marcus is pretty busy.
Okay, so so maybe we can wrap it up. I just want to say that.
I have just another one. You told us you.